Okay, thank you very much for your introduction. It's a pleasure to be with you, see so many young people. And before I start, I want to give another answer on the question on Afghanistan. I have another answer on your question you just posed on Afghanistan. I have been the president of the International Music Council, which is a non-governmental organization in affiliation with UNESCO. And in Kabul, there is the National Institute for Music and Theater, working with young children to make music, traditional and classical. And the International Music Council and the European Music Council have supported this institute by inviting children, musicians, and the leadership to come to Europe to present their music, to be taken serious on an international platform, to fundraise for instruments to be bought in Kabul, and also to make it possible that teachers from the European hemisphere could go to Kabul to teach, and also to work on an archive of traditional and Afghanistan folk music. So there are ways of doing this, and part of the answer to your question is that international networks can do enormous, tremendous, important works for these regions which are basically in trouble. But that's just an answer on the question from before.
Can I conclude the question? The question was quite different.
Yeah, the EU, if the EU can help, I don't know. The EU has a lot of problems, as I will show in my speech, but international non-governmental organizations can do a lot.
Yes, but we know that the ISAF meeting will end in the end of the first of December.
Yeah.
And this is a problem.
Yes, it's a problem.
What will happen in that country? Will
I cannot solve that for you.
Just 20
minutes, and
we start.
Mr. Sarmast, you know Mr. Sarmast? Yes, okay. So that's what I'm talking about.
So you chose as a topic, maybe we try to. You are, as in the first place, a cultural.
Yeah. Well, let's start. We come back to that later. It's a happy and unhappy coincidence that this all takes place in the middle of the elections for European Parliament. And there are a lot of worries about the outcomes of these elections, and the EU sceptics will play a more important role, unfortunately, than in the past. And we are also, at the moment, shortly after that, will elect new high-ranking officials, like the successors to Barroso, Van Rompuy, Schulz. There will be a new commission, and the whole picture will change. And the general discussion we see now is not so much the discussion about culture or cultural programs or cultural diplomacy, but one cannot escape that there is a lot of talk about power structures and the stupid simplification, more Europe, less Europe. And those who speak very loud in this respect ignore, and now I'm quoting a document, the Cultural Coalition for Citizens of Europe. I advise anyone to take this book at hand, which is about my subject. They ignore that Europe cannot be a mere political framework for the convenience of government. It must be made clear that the purpose of European integration is primarily to enhance quality of life for its citizens. The active involvement of citizens is unthinkable without participation that is taken seriously. A citizens' Europe implies participation beyond the dry confines of bureaucratic regulations and job creation programs. It involves all the activities necessary for real social justice and dialogue. It requires the political structures to provide citizens with the mobility, freedom, and the resources to make the most of the opportunities of our time. I could go on, but I cut it short. This comes from a document, A Cultural Coalition for a Citizens' Europe, and I'd like to continue with another citation from Raymond Weber, who is chairman of the Marcel Ikter Foundation for Cultural Democracy. The essential paradox of Europe is to be a large internal market trying too belatedly to evolve to a citizens' Europe. And even though the Europe of states and the Europe of offices remain widely dominating to the Europe of the citizens, as called so by Luc van Middelaar, the advisor to Van Rompuy, the European citizenship, despite its primitive state, is also a real destiny and a big project. It shapes a modern and instrumental citizenship with more rights than explicit duties, but also a multicultural citizenship beyond the national framework. The principles of this citizenship, according to the philosopher Catherine Withold de Wenden, are citizenship based upon living together, citizenship based upon a social contract, rights and responsibilities are reciprocal, and to quote, it is a citizenship that is superposing national citizenship. It is an additional legal identity next to the national identity. Dual citizenship is not citizenship of two nations. It is aside a national citizenship, a citizenship of the Union. And the Union is, in the words of Van Rompuy, the president, something original, unique, the largest area of democracy, freedom, prosperity, and social justice in the world, basically. It's something else than a supranational, intergovernmental, multilateral international organization. There is no other existing comparable form of state. It is the application of the concept of the democratic constitutional state to an international organization. But it is new, it is unfamiliar, and it is largely unknown. And things which are unknown are risky and dangerous, like, for example, the position of the arts. Speaking about citizenship, the phenomenon of the European citizenship began in the Treaty of Maastricht in 92, and it was strengthened in Amsterdam, Treaty of Amsterdam, 97, Nice, 2001, and Lisbon, 2007. It was meant, coming back to the text from Maastricht, to create amongst the citizens a sense of belonging to the EU, reflecting the core values, the common principles, as freedom, human dignity, democracy, human rights, equality, and rule of law. Who could be against that? There was something more in the Maastricht Treaty. It also said the EU Commission should take account of the cultural component in every one of its measures to guarantee the cultural diversity of Europe. Who could be against? But did it happen? I think no. Especially when we put the spotlight on the cultural aspects of citizenships, traditions and beliefs and ways of life and the creation of meaning, I would like to come to a text made by the Generalitat de Valenciana, Valencia in Spain, who say human beings are creators of culture, and at the same time, culture is what makes us human. Our citizenship is therefore cultural. Culture shapes our common value system and at the same time helps to establish a sense of self in an increasingly fast-paced and fragmented world. Culture and the arts can simultaneously strengthen social bonds, enable communication, and stimulate out-of-the-box thinking. We heard that this morning, the Mexican ambassador, thinking across European borders in a unique and avant-garde way. When citizens have common cultural aims, even if the cultures themselves are different, cross-fertilization of ideas becomes a way for active citizens to develop a common Europe while keeping their own sense of who they are intact. To wonder what kind of citizenship we want is to wonder what kind of relationship we should establish with culture. So far, the Spanish community of Valencia. Why stress the cultural components of citizenship? I mentioned already Raymond Weber, who says this is in order to differentiate the contradiction between ethnical and religious diversity. It is in order to create a multicultural citizenship based in human and cultural rights. It is in order to make citizenship different than only a legal concept. And it is in order to let cultural democracy work, especially for the empowerment of the weakest. On the other side, the arts should play a role in and make herself responsible for civil society. See the report of the Dutch Arts Council in 2007, speaking about the arts. They call for more attention to be paid to the role of the individual, the relation between past, present, and future, meaning and depth, and calls upon the art world to operate in an interdisciplinary and international way that transcends sector boundaries. This is supposed to lead to more alliances with other social partners in the fields of education, science, the world of industry and commerce, and social organizations. The Council apparently assumes that the art world is part of civil society and is therefore not only responsible for the generation of art productions, but can also be held accountable for the links that the art institution enters into with its surroundings. Arts institutions should and can play an intermediary role between different citizens. Citizens on one side, citizens on the other side, citizens abroad and at large, and between civil society and the political class. The trouble with the artist is that they bring you in contact with the unknown, like the dual citizenship I just mentioned. And to bring you in contact with the unknown is risky. Hence, especially the arts are the victims of budget cuts decided upon by populist parties which want to avoid that we come into contact with the unknown, let alone to appreciate that. These parties are against the arts because it relates to the unknown, and are against dual citizenships and against the EU because it brings you in contact with the unknown. Now back from the arts to culture in a broader sense. There was a time that there was even a European agenda for culture. Culture as a set of distinctive spiritual and material traits that characterize a society and a social group. The philosopher Isabel Henning says that in various conventions, charters, treaties, you find that there is a right to culture, which is the right of an individual to enjoy culture in all its dimensions, to play an active role in protecting, promoting, and also creating new traits of culture. This book is really worthwhile to read, therefore I have... I will say where it is. I come to an Italian important figure in this debate, Pierluigi Sacco. His plea is for something not different but additional, saying he speaks about active cultural participation. With that we mean a situation in which individuals do not limit themselves to absorb passively the cultural stimuli, but are motivated to put their skills at work, not simply hearing music, but playing, not simply reading text, but writing, and so on. By doing so, individuals challenge themselves to expand their capacity of expression, to renegotiate their expectations and beliefs, to reshape their own social identity and cohesiveness. The interesting aspect of active participation is that individuals are not simply exposed to cultural experience, but take a dive into the rules that generate them. They have to learn to play with the source code that is behind the generation of cultural meaning. Active participation, on the other hand, fosters further interest and curiosity towards exploring cultural experiences and goods produced by others, a classical positive feedback dynamics where each component reinforces the other. And also, he talks about spillover effects of culture. He did this during the European Cultural Forum 3 years ago here in Brussels, in the Flagey. And he speaks of about five spillover effects. One of them being social cohesion, the development of a sense of citizenship, which contributes to a juvenile crime prevention possibility, conflict resolution, overcoming of self-stereotyping and others' stereotyping. Welfare is the second one, life expectation, psychological well-being, reduction of rates of hospitalization and resort treatment, which will save in the end a lot of public money. He had a plea there to introduce the arts and culture in a much higher degree in all societal realms, saying that it would save enormous amount of hospitalization costs. It has been studied by him that listening to music in the first place create a much higher well-being in both a physical and psychological sense. The second one on the ladder being going to the theater. There was only one thing, and the whole room laughed at him, that the negative effect, so the other side of the coin, was that people who read poetry have more physical problems and more psychological problems through reading poetry. But he said, my investigation is not yet ready, and I have to find out how this comes. There is a third aspect which has to do with sustainability. Cultural participation may have an important indirect role in fostering social mobilization and awareness about the social consequences of individual behaviors related to environmentally critical resources. I want to point out here also to the UNESCO Hangzhou Declaration of 2013, Hangzhou in China, a conference organized by the Chinese, where it was established, a document of 3-4 pages is also online at UNESCO and the UN, culture as a key pillar in the for the sustainable development, a very important document which is now being on its acceptance travel within the UN. The fourth aspect of these spillover effects is innovation, cultural participation as a driver for endogenous economic and social growth. And as a last one, the effect in favor of local identity, catering for global visibility of one specific urban milieu, redefining the social and symbolic foundations of the place and stimulating new dynamics of production of cultural content and new modes of access by local communities. So the spillover effects of culture are extremely important. That's one thing. However, it will not be long. All of this, what I've just said, is now at the moment drowning in the debate around the elections. Against Europe, pro-Europe. More Europe, less Europe. Nonsensical, of course, because Europe exists. There is a total confusion about not making difference between Europe and the EU, but even the EU exists. The problem of this EU dominates the debate, especially the organs of the EU. I come back to, I quote François Mitterrand in the past, he says, in biology, it's the function, the functionality which creates the organ. In the EU, it's the other way around. That it is the organ creating sometimes, or quite a few times, the functionality. Opinions about these organs of the EU come from three sides, and we have to make that very clear in discussing and thinking about it. There is noise and arguments and talking from the inside. What is the inside? That is those who are in the system, civil servants, politicians, MPs, managers, executives. The second group is the involved outside but involved, which are the national civil servants, politicians, MPs, managers and executives. And the third grouping is the real outside, which is the citizens. It's very difficult to underline, to see, to make distinction between who is saying what at what moment. And it seems as if these three layers with different points of departures are not willing to listen to understand, to internalize, to appreciate the position and the arguments of each of the two other layers. There is a lack of sensitivity. We live generally from images, not in realities. An image once created can hardly be corrected, changed or adjusted. On top, in the information society, despite the information society, many facts and figures are not known or not noticed. And in this vacuum, it seems that the contact between EU leadership and all kinds of responsibles and the citizens on the other side has gone astray. It's, of course, I'm generalizing a bit, and I talk in general terms, and of course the excellent and present company is totally excluded, but these three groupings, in fact, are part, the performing arts are coming back, of a tragedy of errors. The whole system is, with a beautiful German word, fehlgeführt, by those errors. The inner circle has failed to make sufficiently known what is the function of the EU and what were the achievements, if not successes, in the past. They missed the courage to say where they are proud of, in the fear to be punished due to Euro-positivism. Brazilian bureaucrats believe in their own logics and do not or isn't insufficiently explain. The national organs and their representative are in general the worst. Either they are against everything without any nuance, or they are maneuvering in order by trial and error to counter the against voices, or without hesitation, they are pro, full of exaggeration and in the fork of a kind of sheer optimism. As a consequence of the behavior of these first two groupings, inside and outside involved, there is a nearly complete confusion among large part of the citizens. In this respect, 2013, the European Year of the Citizen, has not brought the expected results. The biggest failure, which makes the whole construct unreliable and causes disbelief among citizens, is that national executive, again listing government, individuals, groupings, fractions, MPs especially, say A in Brussels and B at home. The story at home is, we defend the national position. The situation in Brussels is, we agree in unanimity and allow ourselves to accept substantial compromises. Even worse is the situation just before the elections, so nowadays, the last months and weeks and the days before the elections will finish on Sunday. Political parties move from one point of view to another. Last week we were in favor of a European army, now we are against. 1 month ago we were in favor to further negotiate with Turkey, now we are against. Political leaders apologize for slogans about promises they have not realized or they could not realize. Parties, leaders, delegations in the European Parliament promised to achieve results, however, they did not achieve them. The outcomes of the procedures were different from the promises, and now they offend the outcomes, which creates enormous amounts of disbelief and makes parties and leaders unreliable. Voters, voting citizens, do not know what an elected MEP is going to do to vote in the European Parliament, in the greater units of Christian Democrats, Liberals, Labour, Green, and even right-wing populist parties. Often the voters in these subgroupings, fractions, delegations, represent something else than what their colleagues in national parliaments vote for, from with substantial nuances till completely the opposite. It is the battle, who is the strongest in telling the people, the citizens, what the people, the citizens, they think want to hear. At least Angela Merkel dares to say economic cooperation has to be followed by political cooperation, which is very courageous. On top, the whole construct of the EU, the construct of decision so far, is at least a co-responsibility, if not the full responsibility, of the leaders of the member states. So complaining that this has gone too far is inadequate and makes them totally unreliable. It's nearly finished. nonsense is, these elections are about Denmark. We will create jobs for you in Brussels. Brussels doesn't create jobs. Brussels cannot organize unemployment quota. One of our Spitzen candidates will lead the EU. It's legally nonsensical. There is no treaty which obliges the leaders of government to choose one of the Spitzen candidates. There is, on the other side, insufficient explanation of the raison d'être of the EU. Also from a historical point of view, in history you've seen it is a guarantee for peace, freedom, welfare, and well-being. There is not enough, neither discussion nor well-supported proposals for the real core matters which are at stake in European policy-making. The environment, energy, think of gas, Russia, Ukraine, water, food, foreign policy and defense, migration, the terrible problem with refugees, knowledge development and innovation. There is a little bit of success in the union of banks in order to solve the and prevent new financial economical crises. But the main common program is still agriculture. Many billions are spent there in the EU of the 20th century. We should aim at an EU of the 21st century, which should concentrate on the items just mentioned and aspects like research, education, knowledge, innovation. A lot of these core issues are obviously not popular enough. What can be the role here of cultural diplomacy? International cooperation should not be confined to forms of national presentations outside the national borderlines. It's time for a new form of cultural diplomacy, and if we could avoid that, as what had happened over the past few months, high-ranking officials and MPs throw mud to each other, we could, when this stops, perhaps go back to our important ideals, as I've listed a few in the above, and then the citizens might like to love Europe again, or finally. The last words are from Václav Havel in the year 87. Only free citizens, conscious of their rights, will be able to imagine, realize, and defend new political programs. Without citizens, there is no politics. Public spiritedness is courage, love for truth, always awakened conscience, interior freedom, and a real responsibility for public affairs. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. It was very interesting. I have a question related to criticism, pointing out that European citizenship concept by itself would be an artificial one. How would you respond to this criticism? Thank you.
The response, well, I said something about this dual citizenship. If you are a citizen of France or Spain, that's one thing. And it is something different than what I try to say. There is a lot of discussion, for example, in the Netherlands where I live, that it's not a good idea that you are Dutch and Moroccan. So you should hand in your Moroccan passport of another country. I don't think that is of any use, but this European citizenship is something else. You are part of this bigger community with all its possibilities and challenges and in the end, advantages. Only we are not speaking the truth all the time, and politicians are moving around in various standpoints and points of view, which make them very vulnerable for all kind of criticism, and also all kinds of nitty-gritty, futile details in legislation are then highlighted. Some are very useful, some not, but that's where the discussion then is, and then it's difficult to create a European citizenship or feeling a sense of belonging to European citizenship, if the discussion goes about very, very tiny, unimportant things, and not that we have to accept that the whole energy problem, environment problems, that should be the core of the discussion. And if we could solve that in a positive, interesting, forward-looking way, it would be much easier to feel belonging to a European citizenship.
Yeah, just show
this book is published by the European House for Culture. It's very easy. There is If you go to info@, and then one word, house for culture, so in English, house for culture is one word, .eu, you will find a whole bunch of articles and declarations on the cultural component of citizenship. It's published about 1.5 years ago, and it's so a lot of inspiration.
So a bit pessimistic, but at least there are some colors.
Yeah, there is. Well, this book is not, it shows you the way, but now with these election campaigns nowadays, which we are all listening to over the past four or five months, you get very sceptic about, is this still truth, and can we work on this basis, although there are wonderful proposals here.
Perfect, Professor, thank you. We have no time for questions at the moment, if you want to ask maybe.
I'll pass them to the leadership, and I will gladly like to answer them by mail or whatsoever. Mr. Donfried has my card and knows where to find me. And yeah, well, we can go outside and have a little chat as well for 10 minutes before I leave.
Juste alors. Thank you very much.